back to Scale Me Down and to another episode of this VQ Models PC6 Pilatus Turbo Porter with a variable pitch constant speed propeller. Please like and subscribe to support the channel. In the last episode, the 3D printers were tied up printing parts for other people and we were waiting to be able to print these propeller blades. Well, they are now completed. Before we can fit them onto the aircraft, we could do to have her up on her wheels and the radio gear into the fuselage. So first, we need to do some standard, almost ready to fly, ARTF fare to do that. Let's get started. I fitted the main landing gear following the instructions and substituting hardware where I deemed it necessary. Landing gear wires are held together by these aluminium blocks. I first marked the wire by fitting the bolts and then removed them and filed flat before refitting the bolts with thread lock. The elevator and rudder servos will have to go right back here as she's very nose heavy. I put a bright light inside the fuselage to show where to cut the hole. I need to do all this before fitting the tailwheel, as space is very limited back here. I used a piece of scrap card fitted with a balsa handle to mark and cut a hatch from some scrap ply on the bandsaw. We are with her nearly up on her wheels, and I brought the aeroplane through to here as there's much better light. We've been working in this area back here in this dark small hole and it didn't really give any useful camera shots, so I'm very sorry, but this part of the build wasn't on film. What you can see, however, though, with that heavy motor out in the front, is just how nose heavy she really is. With that in mind, we've been working back here to put short, stiff carbon fibre rods for the linkages, and they're all connected with ball links. They should be very positive and stiff. I've decided to put the servos back here in the tail also. This was my choice of servo. It's a Savox Sport Digital and it came from my local model shop, Steve Webb Models. It's really worth supporting your local model shop, as the staff there can give you invaluable advice when it comes to choosing your servos and equipment for a model aeroplane such as this one. And in the end, this was much the same price as if I'd have got them online anyway. Whilst we can see that it's so nose heavy, I've decided to use some of our weight budget to change out the tailwheel. The one that came in the kit's absolutely fine, but I've chosen this sprung unit from Hobby King. And we'll make some brackets and fit that to the tail also, which should beef that area up. I used Google SketchUp to draw a bracket to fit the tailwheel. We'll 3D print and fit it in sections around the tail leg. I used small sections of 2mm threaded rod to dowel and reinforce the joints. It will be steered with this 3D printed horn. While we're here, I mentioned that we were going to put a bearing to support this shaft back here. And I 3D printed these bearing holders as a clamshell like this. The idea being that I tack glue them to the firewall like this.
and then fix them with self-tapping screws onto the firewall. But since I made this, I changed my mind a little bit, and I've decided that it would be really useful to put a bearing here on this smaller shaft, on the inner shaft. And so to do that, I've redrawn and reprinted these new clamshells with an extra ridge here to take that extra bearing. And these will fit in the same way back here. This, of course, is the power of 3D printing. What also doesn't show well on camera is the soldering, and what I've done here is I've soldered an end on this Jetty BEC, and that's going to provide power to the receiver through this 2-cell LiPo pack. I've done the ends on the speed controller that fit into the motor, and then this one will go into initially a programming box, this one will go to the receiver, and then here we have the MKTEC isolator. The two flight packs will plug in to provide 12S, and it's not live until we remove this magnetic plunger. This means we don't need this extra spark suppression lead. So, to get all this in, we'll start by taking the front of the plane apart. Here, I'm fitting a new version of that bearing block that I showed you earlier. Removing the motor, I can fix it with self-tapping screws. Then we can reassemble the mount using thread lock and securing the wires so that the motor doesn't eat them. Here is the installed electronic speed controller and the MKTEC isolator. And this Jetty BEC supplies the receiver with power from a 2S LiPo battery. Now that all the soldering is done and we've fitted the electronic speed controller mechanically permanently to the aeroplane, we can continue with the electronic setup. And we're going to use this transmitter, an FR Sky Horus 10. And the obvious thing here is that we can't use the same transmitter that most of the gliders are programmed on. The first thing we're going to do is teach the electronic speed controller, the ESC, the throttle endpoints from the transmitter. So here's how we do that. The first thing we do is we power on the aircraft like this, and then we set the throttle to its maximum position, and that will be here, as I'll explain in a moment. And now we make the system live. Here's our isolator, we remove this plunger and we wait for the tones. Now we move the throttle to its lowest position. There we go, the throttle is now calibrated. The next thing we need is to decide how we're going to control the propeller pitch on this aeroplane. On a full-size turboprop, we have a thrust lever, a propeller pitch lever, and then something called a condition lever. And I propose we're going to try something similar for this model. We're going to use this lever here for the throttle. This will be the condition lever. So we'll have idle cutoff, ground mode, and flight mode. Meanwhile, this lever here that we would normally use for the throttle we'll use to control the propeller pitch, and the specific pitch limits will be different depending on which flight mode that we're in. So the first thing we need then is to set up the electronic speed control into governor mode. And the way we do that is we make the whole system live with this programming lead plugged into this box,
And then we supply it with some power. There we go. And then on the left we have which category, from 1 to 9, that we're in the settings menu. And on the right gives us the value for that setting. So currently it's showing 1 and 1, which means 1 is break type and 1 is break off. And we need to scroll through to governor, which is menu item 6. And we need governor mode 1, which is setting 4. And there we are, that's set.
To actuate the propeller pitch mechanism, I drew this connecting arm with a cavity for an 1/8 inch bearing. We used the modify G-code function in Cura, pause at height. This allowed us to automatically pause the print just before the retaining lip for the bearing, parking the print head out the way. Then we could press in the bearing and resume the print, encapsulating it forever. Here, the finished linkage is snapped onto a ball link directly on the servo arm. The servo then moves the inner piston in and out, changing the blade pitch. Time to try it then. We secured the plane to our heavy wood burner, pointing the propeller in such a direction that if it failed, it wouldn't do any serious damage or injury. So far, so good. Now we'll check that the governor's working and measure the RPM. Oh dear, one of the blades failed right at the root. Wow. The blade grip and mounting bolt were perfectly all right.
Right, now that we have her back on the bench, we can investigate the damage that was caused when one of the 3D printed propeller blades failed right here at the bolt hole. When that happened, all that torque and energy was dissipated into the fuselage, causing all this damage. Although in fairness, it looks much worse than it actually is. Perhaps we're going to build a test stand to conduct further testing on this propeller system to prevent further damage to the aircraft. I also think we need to change at least the root design of the blade. Perhaps we'll put a little bit more meat on here at the tang, or maybe 3D printed blades isn't the answer at all, and maybe we'll make a mould and make some from carbon fibre. In any case, we're going to mend the fuselage and perhaps recover it. And if you think back to the first episode, I said I wasn't that happy with the paint scheme. I thought it was a bit too dark. Perhaps this event is a good catalyst to do just that. Clearly it has caused a delay though, and I did say that we'd intersperse this project with other air modelling videos to allow the project to catch up, and that's exactly what we're going to do. As we solve the problems, you'll get further updates, however, if you press the bell icon, and of course by liking and subscribing to the video. Thanks for watching, and please revisit us for more progress on this VQ Models Pilatus PC6 turboporter with variable pitch propeller. Thanks for watching.